Thanks so much. And let me, sort of introduce Tapsee to those of you who've been living on a rock somewhere and don't know who she is. She's one of India's most talented actors. She has starred in Telugu, Tamil, and Hindi films. She's won two Filmfare Awards. She's an entrepreneur. Born and brought up in Delhi, Tapsee did her graduation in computer science engineering. She worked as a software engineer first and then went on to a career in modeling and from there on to her very successful career in acting. So it's going to be really interesting to ask you, Tapsee, about that journey from software engineering to acting. You are a fierce, outspoken, independent actor, and that's one of the reasons why you are so loved and admired. Certainly, that's one of the reasons I really admire you. And it's great to be able to talk to you today, Tapsee. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you so much for having me. I hope all the 800 people who are now like putting the pressure of being entertaining enough are going to be happy by the end of it. I hope so.
Well, I actually was going to ask you what Manika, commented on, which was your pictures from your holiday in Russia. And I really like them as well because nobody's being really able to go on holiday anywhere. So my first question was, what was it like to get out and take a holiday in the middle of this pandemic? What was that experience like? Because I saw in your pictures that a lot of the streets were actually quite empty.
I'm in Moscow, yes, but St. Petersburg, it was very crowded because there was a football match happening there, so it was very, very crowded. But yes, it did. I wanted to go there to feel normal, like it's not as bad as it was getting when I was here, like in my head at least. So I wanted to feel normal that life is not finishing as yet, because you almost had that feeling because you were losing so many people in your life. Who you knew personally. So I wanted to feel little normal and roam about on streets, sit in a cafe on roadside and just walk without a mask, or just to feel that fresh air on my face and without worrying about who is clicking my picture, who is commenting and judging me for the way I'm looking. So, there are certain kind of freedom that we enjoy when we step out of the boundaries of the country. So I wanted to feel that. So I feel rejuvenated enough to come back to a lot of work that is waiting for me. So I just did that.
That's great. And what was the lockdown like for you personally? I mean, everyone's had their lockdown stories, their struggles, the issues that people are still dealing with. But for you, what was that like?
This particular lockdown was hard. It was difficult, much more than the last one, because the last one was, the first experience. So you're still trying to wrap your head around it, trying to like see the good and the bad side of it, trying to like discover new things about yourself. In those 4 or 5 months that you want to know, like you're just like at peace with yourself. Never gotten that kind of time with yourself before, so that way somehow managed to get through the first lockdown. But the second was very sudden because I was busy filming, and then suddenly the lockdown was called, and we were at home, and it just didn't seem like it was ending, and we started losing a lot of people we knew. The cries for help that were coming not just on my social media but on my WhatsApp on daily basis. You wake up to news like, okay, this one is no more, that one is no more. And it's not like those big famous, just those big famous names. They are the ones coming from your extended family or, the immediate family of your best friends. And I lost my editor of Rashmi Rocket in this pandemic, this lockdown. So these were when they happen once in a while, you were at least able to get out of it. But when they happen on daily basis, before you recover from one news, there's another one hitting you, which eventually takes a huge toll on your mind. And that's exactly what happened. So I was yearning to get out and feel that, okay, my life is not ending as yet, because it almost felt like that. Because you were like, okay, this feels like it's never going to end. You almost had that hopeless feeling that this is never going to end. So when this opened up and I got to know that there is an opportunity to go out, within a week, my plan was set and I was out.
When you said that the lockdown, in a way, also gave you an opportunity to learn new things about yourself, is there something you can share with us about what you learned
Yeah,
about?
I never thought I could cook so well. I don't like cooking. I detest it. I don't like getting into the kitchen at all. I love eating. So I enjoy my food a lot. I love my food, but I don't like cooking it. Too much of patience is required for that. It's an art, and I never thought I have this art, which requires a lot of patience. So I had no other option. It was just me and my sister. We were stuck. So after the first day of cooking that my sister did, I realized I don't think I can survive this whole pandemic or this whole lockdown with her cooking, because it just didn't taste that well. So I was like, for a person who loves to eat so much, like so I love eating. I love eating. So I say, if I have to stay sane in this lockdown, I have to take the control of cooking in my hands. So I started cooking. I got a hang of all these YouTube videos of cooking. I still, in my notes, have a huge list of each dish along with the YouTube link of the recipe I need to follow. So I used to make all the meals by myself the whole day. A lot of day used to go in that. So I think that side of me, I would have never discovered had it not been that lockdown.
So let's get to know you a little better, apart, you know, from what's happened in recent months. But tell us a bit about your childhood. I mean, you were born and brought up in Delhi. What was it like? We know you have a sister. Are there other siblings? Was it what you would say, a regular, normal childhood in that sense?
I think normal childhood is very underestimated. So everyone likes to hear some kind of like crazy up and down story of childhood of a person who is like a public figure right now. But fortunately or unfortunately, I didn't really have a crazy childhood. I had a very, very normal, regular childhood with a regular middle class family where the father goes to work, mother is a housewife, a homemaker. I have a younger sibling, my sister, the two girls in the family. So very, very, very concerned parents about what time are they leaving from home? What time are they coming back home? Their curfew timings, you know, they're like, okay, high expectations out of your education because it's a middle-class family, you're a service-class family where, you know, always about fixed income should come home after after every month. That stability is what is important. Never took me for any movies because they didn't really like movies themselves. So we used to only watch whatever used to come on television for lunch and dinner whenever we are sitting and watching something on television. So it's that kind of regular, very, very regular where you are judged by how good or bad you are is judged by what people around you think of you. So that's how it's been. My childhood.
When you know, you said that you know, given your family background, this whole sort of emphasis on a steady income, is that what sort of prompted you to go in for this computer science degree? I mean, was that sort of a natural trajectory where, like, I know in my family, before my dad became a journalist, everyone was like, doctor or engineer hi banna hai. So was it kind of like that for you?
Yeah, kind of. So nobody's an engineer in the family, but like my father used to go on a regular job. He used to just manage finances of a company, of a real estate company. He was just so risk-free kind of a person, like didn't like to take any risk in life so much so that he worked in the same company from the first day he ever went to work till the last day before his retirement. He's gone to the same company. He obviously got promotions and all, and probably the bosses loved him a lot, so didn't let him go either. But he's that kind of a risk-fearing man that he didn't even change his company. His entire life, he's worked for the same company. And so obviously the expectation was that I will also get a fixed salary back home. Eldest one in the family. In terms of you know, my dad has two more siblings, so out of those, like at least the two brothers, I was the elder one amongst the cousins. So expectation was, you know, that I'm gonna study, and I unfortunately or fortunately, I was good at studying, so the expectations became even higher that okay, this one though is good, is gonna just like rocket like there. So the expectations were really, really hard on me. It was always about, you know, should get more than this one, more than that one. So I was always busy matching up to that. I remember my final year in my 12th exam, I had never touched an aggregate of 90, which I did in my 12th. Yeah. And I was, I think a few percentage short of the number one ranked person in the school. I came second, and that also I never came second. Also, I was in always top 5, top 10 kind of a category, but never like one or two in the class. So when I was so happy, I thought, okay, now at least my father will be really happy. And when I told him my percentage, he's like, okay, you know, if you would have worked a little harder, as I told you, you would have come first. So that was his first reaction after he got to know my marks in my 12th board. And I was like, I don't think I can ever. I think that was one of those moments I realized that it's impossible to make people around you happy. It is impossible. So it's better that you think of your own happiness, because you can never make everyone happy around you.
Well, I guess sometimes parents have, they sometimes think that they're pushing us harder with the best interests at heart, and you know, you're right. You can't make everyone happy all the time, even your own family. So, you know, you have to put your happiness first. So then, so you got into software engineering. What was that like? And
so I never worked as a software engineer. I was placed. I got placement, campus placement in INFI. That was the first company that came for placement in my third year. So I sat. The first company that came, and I was like, somehow I have to just make it in this one, because I don't want to sit for placements any further, because I was sure that I don't want to do a job. I was even sure that I don't want to pursue engineering like further. I wanted to do my MBA after that and then get into marketing. That was my aim and what I wanted to do without any pressure of, you know, family or friends. This is what I wanted to do. So, but I had to secure that risk-free parents of mine who were like, okay, you need to secure one seat here, secure one seat there. So much so that for my graduation also, before I got the result of my engineering entrance exam, they made me secure a seat in Hansraj College in Delhi in computer science honors, just so that in case I don't get into a good engineering college, I have a good college and a seat in a good college to do something. And so that security at risk-free life that I was always taught to have kind of started suffocating me after a point. And I was like, you know, this is never going to end. As I told you, this, I can never make everyone happy. I can never achieve. They'll never be number one. There'll always be people above and below you. They'll always be. Now it's your perspective. Where do you look? You always keep looking at the people above you and say, oh my God, I didn't get this. Or you look at people below you and say, okay, I would have been there also. So you should be just happy that you could make it till here. So I had to like take that decision after a point and live for myself and my happiness than to reach those lines that people had sketched for me to achieve.
You mean not compare yourself always to other people?
Yeah, just think of, it's one life. It's my life. It's one life. I'm not going to get to live it again my way. This is the only life I have. I have to live it my way.
So what was it like when you told your sort of risk-free, risk-averse parents that you want to become a model? How did that happen and how did they react to that?
So it was not a career move. It was a pocket money move, because I did not, my parents never gave me a fixed pocket money, because they were like, okay, whenever you need money, you ask for it. What is it for? And we'll give you the money. So, you know, when you turn 18, you feel like, okay, now you're an adult. You want to spend money the way you want to. And I've always been the odd one in the family who never liked to look at the menu from the right to left. So it's always been, I want what I want without looking at a price tag. So it used to be nightmares for my parents when we had to go out for shopping, because they used to get instructions for like minutes and days before that you will not do this, you'll not do that, you'll not behave like this, you'll not, because if I like something, I want to get it. So I think then they were like, okay, when you start earning is when you'll know the value of money. So I said, okay, let me just try and earn it, and then let me know what is the value of money. So I wanted to earn my own money so I can spend it without made to feel like it's a sin to spend so much money. So that's why I started modeling, because that's the only thing I could do along with my graduation. So in my second year, I knew that I don't want to pursue engineering. I just liked maths and physics is why I got into engineering, but I don't want to do it for the rest of my life. I'll do my MBA. So I'll just finish my engineering properly. I will. I'll not leave it in between. But I'll do something else to earn some money also, which I can spend. So I started doing that. And I remember me and my mom went for my portfolio shoot without telling dad, because we were 100% sure that dad is never going to let me do it. And obviously, we hid it from him for a long time. I used to go for a photo shoot in Delhi, like once in a week or something, bunking a few classes and, earning some money for that photo shoot and spending it. And then he got to know after some time, when my pictures started appearing on hoardings and newspapers and editorials, because I was only shooting for, like, in Delhi, you don't really do much of ramp show. And I was not keen on doing ramp show because there used to be like late night shows, which I couldn't. There was a curfew timing. I could only do these photo shoots for brands, and they started appearing in magazines and all of that. So I figured out it's time that, I'll have to tell him, confess to it. And he got to know after some time, and he was extremely upset. And obviously now he really denies all of that, doesn't own up to that. But he had sleepless nights. He was just like thinking, because in his head, he thought my girl is going to not stop studying. This was the only one in the family who used to get good number, because they had literally no expectations out of my sister. They were like, you just pass. Somehow you just pass. That was the instruction given to my sister. And for me, it was always like, you need to top. You need to just be the best all the time. So he was really scared that I'll leave my education in between because of this fame and this, this whole thing that comes, glamour that comes with this industry. And I had to really make him believe that I am not a person who's swayed away by glamour and fame, because I didn't even do a school play or drama that much. Like, I was never interested. I'm a trained dancer. I used to love performing, but not like, I never thought of it as a profession. It was just a hobby always. So it took me a little while to convince him to let me do what I want to do. And I'm not going to shortchange my education for that. Finally, he gave into it when he realized that I used to get good numbers after the end of every semester. Eventually passed my I did my graduation with distinction. So he kind of believed eventually when he started seeing the results. Yeah, and then the struggle was to ask him to let me use 1 year of my life the way I would want to, by giving the films that I was getting. I was getting offers for films because of modeling. So I thought I'll give it a shot, because I can try films right now. MBA I can do a little later, because anyway, I didn't clear the kind of colleges I wanted to go to in the first attempt. So I thought I'll give it again the next year after dropping 1 year. So meanwhile, I thought I'll just like earn a little more money and learn something new and go and act. I'm getting offers anyway. So that was again a little bit of convincing required. But this time it was not as hard as the first one, because he believed that I genuinely will come back and finish my MBA. And it was just a fun thing that I'm trying with my life. And I asked for that 1 year out of my life, and he gave me that. And I went and I did two films, actually, simultaneously, one Tamil and one Telugu. I was probably one of those few debutants who was shuttling between two films, two languages, because I was just doing it for the sake of experience, just like, trying something, experimenting in life.
How did you get proficient in the languages? I mean, you were born and brought up in Delhi, so how did Tamil and Telugu happen for you?
Yeah, you learned. So I thought I will learn it, because, when on the call, when I used to get these offers, I used to tell them, listen, neither do I know how to act, nor I know the language. So yeah, how are we going to do this? So then those people there were more confident than I was. They were like, we'll teach you. We'll teach you language. We'll teach you how to act. So I was like, okay, fine. If they're so confident about it, for me, it's an experience in life. Let me just go and see what happens. So someone who never even went for night stays or night over stays to friend's house in Delhi, because that's how strict my family was, I packed my bags and landed from Delhi in Madurai to shoot my first film alone. No mom, no dad with me, no sister, nothing, alone. And since then, I have been traveling alone, never really had family accompanying me on any set. I think my dad just saw the result of the films. I got three films before even the first one released. So the buzz was so good because of the kind of directors I was working with. I did my Google research well before signing the first film. So I think that kind of like made him feel like this is something probably that is destiny. And I don't think anybody can fight their destiny.
But you know, that's quite incredible. I mean, a girl from Delhi going on to do films in the South and doing them in two different languages. And it was a big success for you. I mean, that's where you had your initial success, as you pointed out. And then you moved on to the Hindi film industry. And you've spoken about this in the past, about how it, you know, you were basically an outsider. No godfather, no connections. And the industry wasn't exactly the most welcoming to you. Tell us a bit about that and the challenges that brought with it for you.
So obviously, I mean, it's not like it was a hidden secret or something that it's going to be difficult. Anyone who says that probably has not done their homework well, and it's their fault. I knew that I'm an outsider. It's going to be a difficult journey. It's going to be a longer route. It's going to be harder. But if I achieve what I am out there to achieve, the credit will be solely mine. And there is no bigger joy than that, trust me. Today, there's nobody who can stand up and say, "Ke, ye meri wajah se. Because of me, this girl is where she is." Nobody can do that. That's so gratifying, because you can take the credit of your own success. That's so fulfilling as a person, which nothing can match. So I'm very, very proud I'm very happy outsider, not a bitter one. I had my share of struggles. I'm proud of those, because that really made me, or failures, that really taught me what is this success worth. Obviously, if you don't see the bad side or the downfall, so to say, you don't value the upside that much, because my first Tamil and Telugu films were hits. So for me, when I started seeing failure after that, I didn't take it well. Because for me, the first one was a hit. I thought, okay, with this much of effort, if I can get a hit, so that's just very easy. So that's when that first failure really hit me hard. By the time I came to Hindi, I was well versed with the extremes of success and failure. So I was better at taking it. But it was a bigger pond. There were too many fish, like in this particular pond. So it was, and you had done a certain number of films when you were coming from South. But here you are being treated as like any other struggling newcomer, which used to initially feel like, okay, it's just because I've not worked in Hindi, I am a nobody for them. But I have put more effort and given, you know, better results than a lot of others who are sitting ahead of me in events, in the rows ahead of me. But I was obviously treated like someone who is just like, you know, beginner, struggling or whatever. I knew I will be treated like that. But when I got a taste of that, it didn't feel that good. So I thought, you know, better than being bitter, I'll just go back home and stay there till the time they actually know, you know, what I'm really worth eventually. So I waited for a couple of years, didn't attend any events, any of these big award shows, or I waited for a few years until it valued to have me. And then I started attending all that, where then I was treated differently. Rejections are the ones that make you get back stronger. I've been thrown out of films. I've been rejected for like really random reasons, including that, you know, the hero doesn't want you to be in the film, which is very, very random, I feel. So I have had like some really crazy, bizarre, misogynist, patriarchal experiences in the industry, outsider versus insider kind of experiences, where someone else just gets an edge because, you know, people don't even let me sit in an interview with a big journalist because I'm an outsider, and it takes me like years and consistent success for me to even sit across big journalists. And there are people who, even before their first film releases, are sitting across and getting that platform to tell about, you know, their journeys, which has just not even started. So I've seen that side. But again, I'm not bitter about it. I really enjoy it that, you know, I have traveled that journey. I have those experiences which I use in my performance. Because I don't think anyone who's been born with a silver spoon can really present, or those experiences help me perform in real way, with, you know, real characters, which I feel is an edge I get over a lot of others who got things easy.
That's a very, very interesting and a positive way to look at it. That's terrific to hear. And in fact, we have so many questions, you know, from our students and other participants. Ashish, are you there? You have a question for Tapsi? Ashish?
Good evening, ma'am.
Hi. Good evening.
Yeah, good evening, ma'am. It is so nice to actually finally... not Octave, I've been actually waiting for it. I know.
Thank you.
Yeah, so,
what's your question, Ashish?
Yeah. So the thing is, my question is, you know, I mean, more especially in South India, we have many things which surround a woman, actually, a girl, you know, the stigma which they have. I mean, films are not for our child. Films are for somebody else. Modeling is not for a married woman and all that. So, you know, why? I mean, so I want to hear, like, yeah, like, you know, how do we actually, you know, tackle all that? No.
Good question, Ashish. Because Tapsi, about the misogyny of the film industry in general. Tapsi, you want to take that? Thanks so much for your question, Ashish. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Misogyny and patriarchy is not just in our film industry. It's everywhere. We live in a patriarchal society. So I think every sector, there are hardly any sectors who are actually devoid of patriarchy or misogyny. So our film industry is not any different. You can only do something about it by being that change, or at least being a part of that change. I am never going to take the credit of the fact that, oh, I brought about the change. No, it has been a very collective effort of a lot of other females along with me. Like for me, when I saw a Dirty Picture on screen, which was like pretty at the beginning of my career when I was starting off in South, I saw Dirty Picture and I was like, oh, wow. So a woman can headline a commercial mainstream film, make it a box office success like that. So since that time, Vidya is a hero for me. And I've always looked up to her. And then there were so many others who followed and did some wonderful commercially successful mainstream films. Because usse pehle, the notion was mostly that of a woman-driven film, a woman hero film can only be an artistic offbeat film. And it's only a man when he's a hero, it can be like the commercial mainstream film, which is changing now a lot, which is so wonderful to see. So you can only expect the change when you become a part of it or you add to it. So I'm doing my bit by doing that. As I told you before, I've come across some really crazy, bizarre situations of misogyny. When I tell this to people, they find it very appalling and funny somewhere. But at that point, it was not funny. It was very hurtful. It was like very frustrating, because I didn't know at that time, what can I do in my capacity? So the only way I could get back to them was with success. So that's when you don't give up because of these problems. You just don't give up on your beliefs because of these problems. Because if I give up today, or like other women in the industry give up today, there'll never be a tomorrow of equality. So if we give up today, so I know that maybe in my lifetime I won't see an equal society in my industry, but I know if I give up, my next generation also won't see it. So I can't give up because of that.
Absolutely, well said. Anjali,
thank you, thank you very much, ma'am, for your words. Thank you very much,
Anjali Prasad.
Yes, ma'am. Good evening, ma'am.
Go ahead, Anjali.
Ma'am, I had a question about the wedding factory you have. So I just wanted to know its journey, like how did you get idea for that and all. I just wanted to know about the journey. Like, I'm doing a business management, so I'm interested in doing event management. So I wanted to know about it.
So my final funny and weird that there are certain businesses in India that are recession proof. Marriage is one of them.
That's true.
Yeah. So it is so crazy that it is lockdown proof as well. You wanna like it's crazy the number of requests we got for weddings, to organize weddings, even during lockdown when there were only 10 people allowed, you know, then slowly 20, 25. Even in that, people were just like wanting desperately to get married. So I think that's one business that's never going to go out of fashion or face recession in India is one of the reasons for me to take that up. But on the other hand, my best friend here in Mumbai, she used to work under a very big wedding planner, and she could see the scope the business has and what we can really do with it. And then I think she shared that idea with me, and I said, okay, I'm gonna put in invest some money in this along with you, and my sister will handle it on my behalf because I can't be really on ground. My sister is good at organizing events and all. She's gotten her diploma in that, so she's the one who's handling it on ground. What my part of the partnership, and that's how it started. Now it's been, I think, 5-6 years at least, 6 years, I think, that it's been going on, and it's been going on quite well.
It's quite remarkable, like you said, how even the pandemic and the lockdown hasn't stopped people from getting married.
I saw my sister actually telling people on phone that, why are you getting married in this pandemic? Like, she was the one actually deselling them the idea of getting married in pandemic. She was like, but it is not safe. It's not right. Please don't get married right now. Wait for some time. And I'm like, this is great business that I'm doing here.
Before I take the next question from one of our students, you know, I just wanted to follow up on, you know, Dapsi, what you said about success and rejection. Just tell these kids what it's like when you first taste success and the adulation that comes with it. And then when you see failure, and like you said, you didn't handle it very well in the beginning, but how do you pick yourself up and keep moving forward? I think this is an important life lesson for all of us.
So I'll tell you, I'll outline the journey that will include my success and failure. And I will not specify my current status because that's out there and open for you all to judge how successful or not successful, average, good, bad, ugly, whatever. That you decide on your own what my current standing is. I'll tell you my journey till here. I'm a girl who after finishing my 12th standard, did not pass the engineering entrance exams that I really wanted to go in, and had to settle in for a very average level institution where I thought I could, like, I thought I deserved better in my head, like all of us do. Very disappointed with my score, but I'm like, okay, fine. I can't afford to miss drop in here. Let me just go ahead and finish it. I'll cover it up in my post-graduation degree. Finished my engineering with distinction because, you know, that thankfully I could pull off, and then sat for my MBA exam in my third year, miserably failed it, miserably. So much so that I cried my heart out after that, calling myself a failure, that I am not good for anything. I'm just a very, very ordinary, average human being. And I have so much a pressure of, you know, everyone around that, you know, you have to score well and all of that. So really hated myself for not clearing the MBA exam in the first attempt. Decided, okay, I will shamefully drop that 1 year and come back again, work hard and come back again. And then in that 1 year, my life changed. I started acting. Someone who never acted in a play or a drama, anything, any kind of acting thing in school or college, suddenly is in front of camera. The biggest medium we have here. So I started doing that, tasted success of the first film. Suddenly, it's literally like an overnight success, right? I don't know how to handle it. Don't even know what this industry is all about. So I'm like, oh, wow, that's very easy. Like most of us think acting is very easy. You just dress up and mouth some lines. What's the big deal in that? And then I got back-to-back failure. after that, because I became too complacent. I did not use my mind at deciding what I want to do, because I did not know any better anyway. So I had back-to-back failures, so much so that I was written off in newspapers by journalists as the iron leg of the industry, which is the bad luck charm of the industry. Whichever film I touch ends up becoming a failure. That I've been officially been written as the bad luck charm of the industry. And that too, when I'm by myself, all alone, in a city that I've never visited before, suddenly no family member, don't know the language, very new to the profession, and this is what I'm going through. So after that sudden success, this big failure takes a heavy toll on me, so much so that I start thinking, okay, anyway, shelf life for girl is only for 4-5 years in the industry. Now you're no more of worth or value. So you move on and you do something else. I'm okay, fine, I'll do some other job. And that's when I suddenly one day get a call for a Hindi film, and I go and meet the people, I get the job, and I do it, and I realize that life is giving me another chance to rectify my mistakes. It's not wrong to make mistakes. It's perfectly fine, but it's wrong when you don't learn from your mistakes. So I made sure I will not repeat a single mistake that I did in choosing the kind of films I did in South, because at that time I did not know any better. So, okay, now you're going to not, now you know what it is. So now you're not going to do that. So I made sure I didn't repeat my mistakes. And as they say, rest is history.
That's great, because, that's what life is. I mean, you have success, you stumble, and it's, we all do. And then it's how you pick yourself up from that and learn from that. So I think that's something that will really motivate a lot of people listening here today. Vamsi, are you there on the panel? Vamsi, you have a question for Tapsee? Hi, Vamsi, are you there, or should I go on to the next speaker? Okay, Saurav. Is Saurav there?
Yes, ma'am, I'm here.
Hi, Saurav. Ask your question.
Good evening. I have this question which comes to play with this current scenario that we are in, where everything is going digital and platforms like Netflix and all, and you guys are promoting to launch films on these platforms. The thing of piracy is increasing. So are you guys aware of it? And as a business opportunity, is it not challenging for you guys to tackle this problem?
But I want to know, was it not there when we had films releasing in theater?
Yeah.
It was there. We were still fighting this problem. So the problem still persists.
So ma'am, I wanted to know, industry, what the steps is being taken so that to stop this?
So there is an anti-piracy cell that is there in the industry. Every time a film releases, the producers are in touch with that cell, and they make a team of their own who try to track down all such links and try to bring them down. But as you know, digital imprints are very difficult to pull down. Like it's humanly, we can say, almost impossible to pull all of them down. Because somewhere or the other, you end up missing out on a few, and then they just explode somewhere. It's something that's beyond your control.
So to be fair, we have to let other people ask questions. A lot of people have raised their hands. So thank you for your questions. In fact, I remember piracy was a much bigger problem, I think. I mean, this is just anecdotal earlier, because you would get those pirated CDs all the time, and I don't see that anymore. Jaya, are you there? Jaya Kota from the team. Hi, Jaya. Go ahead with your question.
Hi, Tapsee. Nice to see you here. I have three quick questions, very quick ones. The first one is, any one character in your films which is, you feel, according to you, is very close to current day's scenario which women are facing?
Okay.
I think I've done too many of such kinds. It's difficult for me to pick. The current day women are facing almost all the problems that I have showcased in most of my films. You be it Pink or be it Thappar, it's there. Those problems are still, even Manmarzi, that commitment phobia and the problem in this, those confusion in your love is what today's young generation is facing. So I think most of my character derive their inspiration out of the real women.
Real life experiences. Yeah. Jaya, one more question and then I'll have to move on.
One more question is, as an entrepreneur, as in, what is one trend or innovation you would like to bring in the business which you have started?
See, trend or innovation in the business that I already have. I have a wedding planning company and I have a badminton team. Right now, my my vision is, because my wedding planning company is kind of like pretty much smooth. My vision for my badminton team is something, you know, badminton is a household name in terms of sport where we think it's just a time pass sport. We don't really value or see it like an international standard sport, actually, which it is. So I really want to get the level of seriousness in terms of how audience perceives badminton as a sport higher than what it is. Get it more commercialized than what it is about, because there's a huge gap between the amount of money our cricketers earn and the amount of money our badminton players earn. My goal is to eventually minimize that gap.
Yeah, that's actually very true of any other sport apart from cricket, or most of them. Joshua, are you there?
Thank you. Bye.
Yeah, I am here.
Hi, Joshua. Go ahead with your question.
Yeah, good evening. Yeah, I just wanted to ask a simple question. Out of all the movies you've acted in, which do you think has had a, lasting effect on you? Not because it, performed really well in the box office, not because it was commercially, big hit, but because it had a lasting impression on you, or because the experience of working on it was just, otherworldly, something you just can't forget.
So unfortunately or fortunately, again, it's a lot of my films have this kind of hard-hitting impact, not just on the audience, but on me as well while I'm performing it, because somewhere I have to give a part of myself to it, which never comes back to me. And I lose that part in the film. The most difficult was Pink, because it started with that. I didn't have a taste of how hard it can be to let go of a character or let go of a part of you with a character before that. So that was a first time experience where I got so emotionally disturbed with a character, and which stayed with me. It took me a long time to wash it out of my system. After that, I got the trick of how to wash it off. So I became better at it. So the first one was very difficult when I did Pink.
I have a question, Tapsee. And, that's about your outspokenness and the fact that, you don't hold back. You express your views very freely on big political issues, whether it was supporting the farmers during their protests or the JNU students, who got beaten in that horrific attack that day. And, you subsequently faced raids by the Income Tax Department. Have you ever been scared, or have you ever regretted speaking out? How has that experience been for you?
No, I've never regretted speaking out, because I don't think I've said anything wrong. I have not targeted any person. I have always called out the sin and not the sinner. I've always stood up on that principle. I'm not an extremist. I don't take names. I don't bring down people. I call out what is wrong. And I will always stand for it. I'll never take my words back, whatever I've said. If you ask me if I was scared, not for myself. Never. It only feels, when you have a family, I've already told you how I have a very risk-fearing family. For them to get accustomed to someone like me who doesn't fear any kind of risk in life is a little difficult. So these things might have impact there, which indirectly will have an impact on me somewhere. But for me, I'm not scared. I always believe if you've not done anything wrong, then you don't have anything to be scared of. And if I have done something wrong, I'm more than happy to serve the punishment for the same. I'm a human being. To err is human. If I have, then I'll be there to serve the punishment. If I have not, what do I fear about?
So, the follow-up question to that is, and I'm sure you've been asked this before as well, is that, you're among the rare voices from the film industry who is not afraid to speak out on these issues. And, the sort of the big, big superstars stay quiet. They stay silent. Do you think they should speak out more on issues that are relevant to all of us as citizens? Or do you understand why many of them just keep quiet? How do you feel about that?
I'm not sure if I totally understand it, because to each their own reasons. But on the other hand, I will never advocate the fact that they should speak up, because it's like you're dictating them to speak up. Then you're actually taking the freedom of speaking up or not speaking up from that person. That person's decision is not to speak up. Who are you to tell that person to speak up? That person never asks you to have that expectation out of him or her that they're going to stand up and speak up on political or social issues. That person was always there to entertain you, and they did that. If you have kept them on a pedestal, which is larger than life, where you have called them out to be real heroes when they only committed to be real heroes, it's your fault. Why are you blaming them for not speaking up? Because they never claimed to be these gods who are coming in your life to save you. They never did that. They were just doing their
life. But they're also people with an immense following and influence. And in Hollywood, you see...
In Hollywood, their houses are not raided. In Hollywood, such things don't happen. The people don't stand outside their houses and throw stones. All that doesn't happen in Hollywood. So let's just stop comparing to our situation with Hollywood. That's unfair to our actors. And they have a following, but they've earned that following with their work. And that's the commitment they presented, that we're going to do a good job where our work is concerned. They never said that, okay, follow us, and then we're going to stand up for you in return. I don't see that commitment ever happening. That never happened. So now you are the one who are keeping them on the pedestal. So that's your expectation that's going wrong.
So one last question, Tapsi. You have another movie releasing in a few days. Tell us a little bit about this role and what we can expect from this film.
It's my first ever OTT release. So I have a kind of weird feeling. I've never had this feeling of how it is to release a film on direct on OTT first. That anxiety of box office number is not there, which I'm quite happy about, because that's kind of nerve-wracking to see how many crores is your film collecting. So that's going to be good. I'm waiting for 2nd of July. Haseen Dilruba is coming out on Netflix. I'm sure all students out there have a Netflix subscription. So I hope they all watch it. And obviously they have Medium. I'm available on all social media platforms for them to tell me if they liked it, hated it, whatever. I'm all ears, all eyes there. And it is a romantic thriller. I am playing a character. Again, I mean, it's becoming very cliche to say that I've not done this before, but I genuinely mean it. I'm not even like, I haven't lied when I've said that I've not done this before or it's different, because I've tried my best to show what is something that is different. It is very, very mainstream, which was made for theaters, very, very commercial mainstream film with a scope of good performances and a very tight, strong, gripping story, because it's a murder mystery along with a love story. So very rare genre. I'm sure everyone's going to enjoy it. I've seen the film. I really enjoyed it. I think you all will have a good time watching it. It's very engaging. So, yeah. Let's see.
Interesting to say that this is new for you. They're doing what's called a mainstream Hindi film role, because you've actually made, a conscious choice to do roles that have been, issues you identify with that have had you front and center in so many ways.
Yeah, but you know, gone are those days when there was such a thick and a clear divide between mainstream and offbeat. Now I think that those lines have blurred. I'll tell you, I'm not a person who watches offbeat films. I'm not a fan of offbeat, because I don't have the patience to absorb that slow burn the offbeat films have. So I don't do the kind of films I don't watch. So neither am I a big follower of these totally brainless masala films, nor I'm a follower of those totally festival ones, offbeat films. I'm somewhere in between, where I want to get affected or I want to feel impacted by the film. But at the same time, it should engage me for 2 hours. It shouldn't be like I'm like falling asleep in between, or like, you know, I'm getting my attention is going somewhere else in between. I want a gripping watch. So that's where that in-between line comes in, where I try to be in between somewhere. And Haseen Dilruba is that. Take your brain with you. I'll never say for my films that leave your brain at home. No, you have to take your brain
I'm glad you said that, because my friend Manika keeps telling me to leave my brain at home when I watch a film, but I...
especially all films this year of mine, you have to keep your brain with you, very much in full focus to watch my films.
Tapsee, thank you so much for taking out this time. I know you're busy with lots of promotions at the moment, but to come and speak to our students, to our student community, and all those who registered here, it's been so wonderful to listen to you, how you got here. And I would like to say a special hello to your parents and, you know, say thank you for encouraging her to do this and pursue her dreams at the end of the day, especially your dad. He sounds a lot like my dad.
Letting me